I'd like to preemptively go ahead and apologize in case this does not work out. Hey everyone, it's me, Aaron.
And I'm Michelle.
And we're in space.
With Peach.
Yes. This is weird. I've been wanting to spice up the post-Geekout reactions for a while because, honestly, yeah, us just sitting in front of the couch with whatever posters happened to be behind us at the time, yeah, it's not really a good setup for this. So, yes, I invested in a green screen. And I've tested it out, but this could all go awry. I don't even know what I'm gonna put behind us for this. Here's the trailer for Deadpool playing, because that's what we're talking about. Here's a panel from Deadpool. Here's Peach. No, Peach! Again, I apologize if this doesn't work, because that just looks stupid. But yeah, okay, so this is a post-Geekout reaction for Deadpool 2. For anybody who hasn't seen a post-Geekout reaction before, A, sorry that we have this weird-ass opening, but again, for us, this is all new and amazing. But B, the post-Geekout reaction is not a review, it's just a discussion between us about the thing that we just watched, and that does include full spoilers. And here's the thing, with the first Deadpool movie, I was like, yeah, there's nothing really to spoil. You know that Colossus is going to be in this, that's only the really big surprise in that. Aside from that, it's a Deadpool movie. Yay, I got Deadpool right. Hooray.
Yay.
There's some shockers in this one. So again, if you have not seen Deadpool 2, tune out now. Everybody good? Okay. Again, also sorry that Peach is scooting around. Peach is amazed by all of this. She doesn't know what to make of any of this.
Yes.
So you're going to hear her rustling around. Nothing we can do about Peach is her own creature. But yes, okay, so Deadpool 2. I really like this. I think I like the first Deadpool more.
Yeah, I feel the same way.
But I'm honestly wondering how much of that is the shock value. Because you go into Deadpool 2, it's like, okay, we've never had the R-rated superhero movie before. And holy cow, they are pushing that R rating. I can't believe what they're getting away with. And oh my god, it's actually Deadpool. They nailed it. They got it in one. They got it in two. They got it right this time. They actually nailed exactly what Deadpool should be. Mm-hmm. So going into this one, it's like, yeah, okay, I know what to expect from an R-rated Deadpool film. Also, I know what to expect from a Deadpool film. So the shock value wasn't there, so I can't really judge like the quality of it versus the first one. But I will say, even without the shock value, I think the first one's still a little bit better because the first one's a little bit more focused.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've noticed that like there are more funny parts in the first movie than the second.
Really?
Yeah,
I've heard people say that this one is funnier.
Yeah, well,
also apologize for the thing in my eye. Keep going.
Yeah, it's like, but like the audience didn't really laugh, but then again we were at the Alamo.
Yeah, I didn't hear nearly as much laughter in this one.
Yeah, it's like I wasn't sure if it's because like it's not as funny as the first one or if it's because we went to the Alamo.
That's the thing about comedies. How funny a comedy is often affected by the crowd that you're in.
Yeah.
But yeah, you're right. I was thinking that too. I didn't hear nearly as many people laughing in this as I heard in the first one. Again, I think it's a funny film. I do.
Yeah.
But comparing it to the first one, I was like, wow, there's definitely a difference between this audience and that one.
Yeah.
But again, the Alamo Draft House is more snobbish, like, oh yes, we're going out here to the cinema kind of thing. But in all fairness, that's us. We're snobs. I'll admit. So yeah, I am wondering, like, if we had gone to UA Court Street, like, how would the audience have been reacting to it? But I still think it was funny, but I think the reason why I liked the first one better, and I can kind of say that was a better film, is it was definitely more focused.
Mm-hmm.
It was, we gotta tell Deadpool's origin story while he's trying to get this guy. That's it. This one kind of feels like three movies all crammed together to me. Because it's Deadpool joins the X-Men, Deadpool goes to jail, Deadpool fights Cable from the future to protect this kid. It's like, all those are good. All those could have been their own movie by themselves. But like, those are the three acts of this film. And there's an X-Force film thrown in there for a quarter of a second in the middle of this thing. Which, man, I feel bad for the X-Force fans out there. Then again, I don't know. The X-Force fans might have looked at the lineup of this X-Force and been like, I don't care about this version of X-Force. Although I will say, that is one of the best twist I have seen all year at a movie, what they do with X-Force. We'll get into that in just a second. But yeah, this one, it really felt like it was kind of going all over the place. But at the same time, I can't critique it that much. Like, I will point to the first one and go, I think that's why that one was maybe a better film. But with this one, it's like, yeah, it's still not like a negative to me that's all over the place because it's a Deadpool movie.
Yeah, Deadpool is kind of all
over
the place.
He's a Looney Tunes character, yeah. And it's like, yeah, man, this is kind of just going from one thing to the next. Only thing that I will say, though, that I can look at as that hurting is whenever this tried to get, like, emotional.
Yeah.
Yeah, because anytime that tried to get emotional, I was like, dude, did you not just see what you did, like, 5 seconds ago? Like, I'm not gonna feel sad now. Yeah, it was weird whenever this movie tried to get really emotional. In fact, in a weird way, I think the emotions worked better in the first one, like his relationship with his girlfriend.
Right.
In there.
Because it was established.
Yes. Also, I just noticed I have slightly green on my shirt, so you guys are probably seeing behind me on this. I'm sorry. I don't know how to use a green screen. Yeah, like, they established it, they really, like, showed you them bonding and stuff. Whereas this one, like, you know, he's trying to, like, reach this kid. I almost did a South Park joke there. He's trying to reach this kid. And it's like, yeah, but I don't really like this kid. Like,
we don't know really much about him.
Yeah, like, we don't really know. They don't call him by his character name in the comics. But, yeah, what was his actual name in here? I know his superhero name was Fire Fist, but it was...
it was Russell.
Russell, yeah.
I remember.
Rusty, that's his
Rusty,
name in the comics.
Yeah. Oh,
in the
yeah.
comics, his name is Rusty, which they actually make a joke about someone else in here called Rusty at one point. And I was like, that's kind of interesting that that came up.
Like, I remember that because, like, Deadpool, like, was thinking of, like, baby names. And it's like, I'm not naming my kid Russell. That's a dumb name. And just like, oh.
But, yeah, we don't really know a lot about him other than that he got abused at this
orphanage?
Whatever it was. Orphanage, yeah.
Yeah, it's like an orphanage that's supposed to, like,
For, like, it's an orphanage for mutants, but, like, it's run by, like, a religious fanatic.
Yeah, and it's basically trying to, like, conform them into being human.
There's a lot that you can read into that, like...
Yeah, there is.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of messages possibly in that. Which... They actually even stop at one point in here to have Deadpool make the joke, X-Men, back in the 60s, we were a metaphor for racism. How's it going? I was like... Kind of feels weird that I didn't, like, keep going with that joke, because now these days the X-Men are a metaphor for racism, but also homophobia.
Yeah.
And when you look at this movie about how it's, like, a religious fundamentalist basically trying to,
use shock therapy.
Use shock therapy to get the mutant out of these kids. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yeah, man, you could have kept going with that metaphor. But in a weird way, I was thinking it's kind of smart that they didn't. I think it's smart that they let the audience kind of figure that one out. If the audience does figure it out.
I don't know, the audience can be pretty dense sometimes.
I'm not getting into that. But yeah, it's one of those things where we know he has a tragic backstory.
Yes.
But as for his actual personality, he's just a dick.
Yeah.
And like I've mentioned numerous times, I have a big problem. Like one of my least favorite tropes out there is the foul mouth, angry kids.
Mm.
Like I hate whenever like the adult has to now be paired up with the foul mouth, angry kid. It's just a trope that I hate. Kept looking at this like, that's kind of what they're doing in this film. Except that, again, like, you look at it and he's loosely, he is a character from the comics, but what he is meant to be in this film is not that character.
Mm-hmm.
In the comics, Deadpool, when he was on X-Force, he ended up finding this kid who was the clone of Apocalypse. And they're like, yeah, he's the clone of Apocalypse. He's going to grow up to destroy the world. And Deadpool was the one guy who was like, I'm not killing a kid, guys. And then Deadpool, like, goes above and beyond, like, everything we've seen Deadpool be before and actually become a serious character and actually go in there to save this kid. And then he gives him, like, a really heart-touching speech about, you can be anything that you want to be. But throughout that storyline, we get to know Apocalypse's clone. We get to know him and see it's like, no, he actually is kind of a sweet kid. And he actually is like, oh, man, but he does have those anger things buried deep down. This kid really is just kind of a dick. So it's kind of like, yeah, man, it might kind of be too far gone for this kid.
Yeah.
Don't want to say that, but. So yeah, I kind of had a little bit of a problem with that in here. But again, I like what they're going for with it.
Yeah.
But let's go ahead and start getting into like spoilery stuff in here. I was really wondering from the start how much his girlfriend was going to be in this. Because she's in like none of the trailers or commercials. She's in like one trailer in which he mentions his girlfriend and you see her in that. And like, wow, you don't see any of her throughout the rest of this. So they came in and they killed her right off the bat. And I was kind of like, that's... I don't know how I feel about that.
But then the credits rolled and they were like, seriously?
That was when I kind of got turned around on this. That's the thing. I was so like, Jesus Christ. Because like, they didn't just kill her. Like, they see Deadpool getting tortured by this. You see him like try to kill himself with the other guy. Like, wow. And then slowly I heard the audience start chuckling as the credits were rolling. I was like... What the fuck was funny about this? And then I noticed they're doing the thing with the credits they did in the last one. I was like, oh, you movie. Oh, movie. But yeah, I didn't really know how to feel about that because on the one hand, it's like, wow, this kind of sucks that you took this character from the last one and just kill her off instantly like that. But at the same time, speaking from the comics, I'm like, Yeah, Deadpool has never had like a long-term relationship. Like, he's had some characters who he's been on and off again, but the character they created for this, not a character from the comics at all. And also, like, you're seeing him be like lovey-dovey and also have like the normal, like, sitting around 9-to-5 life with her kind of like, they sit around and watch movies. And I'm like, I have never really seen Deadpool like that. And it's just kind of odd. So them taking her out, I was like, well, it does get more like he is in the comics, I guess. But the other reason why I'm slightly kind of like okay with this is because when the credits come up and they say directed by one of the guys who killed the dog in John Wick, I'm like, was this a joke? Like, was that like, because that's what happened in John Wick. They kill the dog and then he goes on like a ballistic rage for revenge. And I'm just like, was that, did you hire him first and then write this in the script? Or did you write this in the script and go, you know who we need to get to be able to pull this off? That guy who killed the dog in John Wick. And I'm like, but it like, almost feels like this is a really smart meta joke in there.
In a way, yeah, but like, Deadpool didn't really go on a revenge.
That's, yeah,
it's interesting. Because he feels guilty because he wasn't able to save her. Like, he's basically just spiraling into depression. Like,
yeah, which is an interesting thing that they dealt with in the comics before, like him going through depression. So it's kind of nice they brought that up in here. But again, it's so weird because so much of this is jokey.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't think the balance between jokiness and drama is as good as it could have been.
Yeah.
But in order to make it better, they would have had to put more drama in here. At the same time, I'm like, yeah, nobody wanted to come and see that. Like, I fully realized, like, I would have been fine with that, but I realized, yeah, the audience wouldn't have wanted that. So it's fine. It just kind of makes for an uneven film.
Well, that being said, the action sequences were really awesome.
Oh, yeah. They were great. That one, like, the monologue that Deadpool was doing at the beginning of this, when that guy was running away from him, and you just see all those people running by, he's like, that guy's on fire. That's not CGI. He's actually on fire. I'm like, that's pretty damn cool that they were able to do all that. That's one of the great things about having a martial artist superhero whose suit covers his entire body. Ryan Reynolds doesn't have to learn any of this stuff. You can get an actual martial artist to, like, dress up in outfits. So, okay, like, all the martial arts action in here looks really good, but the stuff that really impressed me was Domino.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all the choreography that went into that, which, yeah, it's CGI, but, I mean, choreography applies to the mind as well. Like, it's, can you think all this stuff out? Go spot for spot on all this. Like, how can you picture all this working out, and can they actually pull it off? Which, I will say, the CGI in here is a little bit obvious at times, but, you know, it's actually better than it was in the first one.
Yeah, part of me felt like the CGI was meant to be not all that good because it is Deadpool.
Like, maybe because it's supposed to look kind of like a cartoon.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot more colorful, it's a lot more cartoonish. I mean, that's, yeah, you can, that's the weird thing. Everything in this movie that I won't complain about, I can kind of like sweep it under the rug by just going, yeah, but it's Deadpool. It's like, yeah, the plot's really all over the place, but it's Deadpool. I mean, that's kind of the point. Like, CGI didn't look all that great, but it's Deadpool. It's kind of meant to look like a cartoon. It's like, you can really argue anything in this for why it works. Again, I think the drama's a little bit that doesn't, like, match up with the comedy all that well, but at the same time, people weren't here for the drama. So, again, it's like, well, yeah, it's Deadpool. That's the thing about this film. This is the most comic booky comic book movie that ever comic book movie. Because this entire film, like, it doesn't even give a shit about plot when it gets to a point in this movie. Because it's just like, yeah, we don't need to introduce characters. Screw it. Have you read the books? Bam, that's them in there. Because, yeah, we'll get into, like, one of the spoilery parts in here. At the prison, there is the biggest, worst guy that they've ever met, and he's being locked up in the basement. And they keep setting up this idea that, well, you better make friends with whoever the biggest guy here is. And Deadpool even turns to the camera and goes, yeah, it's a bunch of foreshadowing. And I was thinking the whole time, it's like, well, the only really big X-Men villain I can think of who might match, like, what they're trying to set up would be Juggernaut, because, I mean, they even had Black Tom in here, and Black Tom and Juggernaut are, like, partners in the comics, which all the jokes they did with Black Tom in here are great. But there comes a point in which I was like, okay, it's either Juggernaut or it's just going to be, like, some really big monster they create for this, like, maybe some really weird, obscure character. But no, it's Juggernaut, and yeah, it's the Juggernaut, like 100%. But there is no setting up, no backstory, no nothing to this guy. It's just, yeah, he's here, giant ass Juggernaut. He just shows up, and I was like, I want to kind of look at this and be like, yeah, well, that's, you know, not really the best writing for audiences who might not be familiar with this guy. But at the same time, I have to respect this movie for turning to the audience and going, we know who we made this for. It's like, yeah, man, I know there are going to be people in the audience who are just going to lose their mind at this. Like, this entire movie is not afraid to go, we don't care if you don't know who any of these characters are. In a weird way, it's kind of like Avengers Infinity War, except Avengers Infinity War had set up before this.
Yeah.
This one is all punchline. Which, again, it's Deadpool. Yeah, like I just said, I kind of want to point at some of these things as flaws, but at the same time, I'm like, yeah, but I know what audience they made this for. And that audience is going to freaking love this. So I kind of have to respect them for doing that. Like, I don't know how you felt about, because I know, like, you know who the Juggernaut
is. Yeah.
But, like, did you feel weird just having him pop up in here?
It's like, oh, hey, that's a big surprise, but at the same time, they're X-Men, so it's like...
Might as well. Yeah. That's the thing about the X-Men, that's the thing about Deadpool. Deadpool feels like it is just on a mission to correct all the fuck-ups of the other X-Men films.
Oh, speaking of which...
Oh, that's way later. That is way later than this.
That's a post-credit scene or later.
Which raises some questions about the next film, by the way. Those have some questions that need to be answered. But, yeah, like, Deadpool, it corrects Deadpool. Colossus in the last one was like, man, you corrected Colossus. That's Colossus. You freaking nailed him in the last one. This one, Juggernaut shows up, and they don't even try to, like, give him backstory or anything. They're just like, it's Juggernaut. We're gonna have him be Juggernaut.
And I was
like,
the Juggernaut, bitch.
God damn it, that's... That's Juggernaut, I gotta give it to you. That is indeed Juggernaut in there. So yeah, man, like, it is really like they were just coming in here to apologize. And even with the new characters they have in here, like Cable. Holy shit, they nailed Cable in one. And I know that, like, a lot of people are gonna be like, well, they don't have his backstory of him dealing with Apocalypse and all that. It's like, it's just, that's a whole thing. Don't even, guys, it's... Do they get the personality right? Do they get the flavor right?
Mm-hmm.
They did, that's all that matters. That's all that matters to me. Do you get the flavor of a character right? Do you get the defining principles of them right? Cable came back from the future to prevent something terrible from happening. It's Terminator, bionic arm, that's it. Total grizzled badass. Yeah, man, they nailed it. They absolutely got him in here. And we talked about how the CGI doesn't look that great on certain characters. Looked really damn good on Cable.
Yes, I feel like they spent most of the CGI effects on Cable.
Yeah, they
because,
did.
Because, like, he's supposed to be, like, the most serious and badass one.
In a way, kind of.
Yeah, well, Deadpool's supposed to be, like, cartoonishy, so it's like, okay, we can get away with some nonsense with him, so.
Yeah, like, it kind of makes me go, oh, sorry. It does kind of make me think that we have a point about how, like, they purposely didn't make the special effects look all that amazing. Because they want this to look like a cartoon, because the one guy in here who's not acting like a cartoon is the one guy who looks really gritty realistic with his CGI. I was like, God damn, this movie might be really smart with its use of this. Deadpool might be the smartest film of the year. Or the dumbest, who knows?
It depends.
Yes. Okay, so Cable, great. Josh Brolin, amazing in this. This is really the summer of Josh Brolin. Not a sentence I ever thought I would say. But he's this, he's Thanos. They even stopped to call him Thanos at one point here. That's another weird thing about this. In the previous movie, they kept making fun of Ryan Reynolds' other films. They kept making fun of Green Lantern, and then they would make fun of the other X-Men films. In this one, it feels like they were like, all right, we're branching out. Because the rest of this film is nothing but jokes about the Marvel Cinematic Universe and the DC Cinematic Universe. Mm-hmm. Except the jokes about the Marvel Cinematic Universe, like, they're not even really that much jokes. Like, the DC ones, they make jokes. Like, they flat out go, so dark and gritty, you must be from the DC Universe. I'm like, that's an amazing line. But the Marvel lines in here, like, yeah, they just call him Thanos. They make fun of Hawkeye. I'll give them that one. That's a legit joke, but like, they'll reference Black Widow. It's more just references.
Yes, it's references.
Which is weird, because this film, they were doing the, like, final bits of it. When the Disney Fox deal was going down, I was like, did you include anything in here? And like, were you taking an early victory lap on this one, being like, yeah, we're about to be with Disney, so we can make fun of Disney now? I was like, nuts.
I don't know.
But it still hasn't happened yet, but it's kind of gutsy. It's gutsy of them. I'll totally give them, and I applaud them for doing it.
Yeah. Did you catch the Stan Lee cameo?
No, I was looking for it.
Oh, it wasn't actually him. It was like a painting of him, like a giant mural on the side of a building.
Okay.
So, yeah. So it wasn't like an official cameo, but I guess it counts.
It's hey man, that's what they do in the Defenders show, so yeah. But yeah, good for them for getting that in there. But speaking of the other characters in here, I freaking love Domino, and if Fox keeps the X-Men around, like I said, we still don't know what the hell is going on with that deal. But Fox is currently at that point in which they're like, I don't know, just make whatever. Like, they're just looking for anything to make. I would be stunned if they didn't make a Domino movie.
I would love to see a Domino movie.
I would love it after this. She was fantastic.
She was so awesome.
I knew from the second she popped in there that she was going to be good because they have that exchange back and forth with her and Deadpool of the, yes it is, no it's not, yes it is, no it's not. Like, just going back and forth on that, I was like, she is really keeping up on this. Like, she is matching him on this. I'm like, good for, like, she has got the charisma, instantly lets you know she does. And throughout the rest of this film, like, everything, like, I've always thought the ability of being lucky was a cool superpower, but I love that they bring up the argument that no, it's not. Like, they bring up that it's like, yeah, that's a dumb superpower and it doesn't exist. I love that this film was just, like, basically trying to address all those people out there who feel that way and be like, yeah, it actually is badass. Watch how badass it is. Because, man, they thought of incredible stuff to do with her in this film. Like, again, just all the choreography and cinematography that went into, like, how stuff just blows up around her.
Mm-hmm.
It's freaking great. But yeah, and she also, she's just got a great freaking personality.
Oh, yeah.
Like, she's incredibly likable in this film. It is, again, kind of the same thing with the Juggernaut, where it's like, yeah, no backstory or nothing like that, just bam, here you go. And like, at the last second, I was like, oh, hey, I used to go here. I mean, I was tortured here. I was like, man, for you to be that big of a character in this thing, it is weird that that's all the backstory we get on you.
And I'm kind of wondering, how does a mutant whose superpower is luck get tortured?
That's a question that I've always kind of had too. Sorry, I had something.
We'll think about that off screen.
I have always thought about that as well. But I mean, people have done explanations on that before, like, oh, it can only go so far and blah, 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 blah. You know, that's how she escaped. I know that some people, like, I think the actual explanation in the comics is that, like, they tortured her before, because she also was tortured as a kid in the comics. But I think it's that, because in the comics, she has white skin, so everyone knew from birth she was going to be a mutant. I think it's that they basically, like, tortured her before she had her powers, is what it was.
Mm.
I think. I am totally spitballing on this one. Sorry, let me know if I'm totally wrong on it. I probably am totally wrong. I'm wrong about lots of things. But yeah, she is so damn good in this. I still really like Colossus. Negasonic Teenage Warhead is not in here a lot.
No, not really.
It's weird that, like, she was one of the breakout stars of the last one, and she's not in here that much. And I know that, like, a lot of people were, like, celebrating, like, oh, they gave her, like, a girlfriend in this. So I was like, yeah, really? Great. Very progressive. Way to go with that film. Again, not really in this movie.
No, it's like she comes in at the end to, like, help stop.
She has, like, no lines of dialogue either in this film. Just, hi, Wade. Bye, Wade. I was like, which I kind of like that running joke.
Yeah.
I like that, like, Negasonic Teenage Warhead hates Wade, but, like, her girlfriend kind of likes him, and they have, like, a really, like, sweet, like, oh, hi, bye thing going on. That's, like, a nice running gag. Also, the running gag of how come I never see any other mutants in this place? You think that the studio could throw us a bone on this one, and then it, like, camera swerves around him, and you see, like, staying right behind him are all the other mutants from the previous films, and they just slowly close the door.
Yeah, it's like, we don't want to associate with you.
Yeah, it's like, I like that. Also, I mean, it's a good joke, but it's also kind of a nice explanation that it's like, no, 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 they're here. None of them like you, and they're trying to stay out of your line of sight. I dug that. I will say, as far as, like, returning characters go, Blind Al really does not get used a lot in here. I mean, the jokes are good, but it feels kind of like, okay, she's here for, like, two scenes. I feel like if you're going to bring her back, might as well, like, have her be a little bit more involved in this.
I guess so, but, like, the thing is, there's a lot of stuff going on
there
in this movie.
Yeah,
so there's only so much you can do with a character before you have to, like, move on
That's
to the next thing. So.
That is very true. How did you feel about what they did with the cab driver in this one?
Interesting.
I honestly, that's like the one running gag in here I didn't really dig. Most of the jokes in here I liked, but that running gag I was just like, ah, oh, that's kind of good. And then, like, eventually I just kind of got bored with it.
Yeah.
But if they make a third one, I am interested in seeing what will become of that. Because no way are they going to drop that joke. So I'm like, okay. I mean, they set up.
He gets upgraded and becomes an Uber driver. Like,
that'd be a pretty good joke. I meant more of, like, what they do with this whole murder spree thing going on. Because they do set up here the idea that, yeah, once you get a taste for murder, it never really stops. And it's like, okay. It's and like, at the end of this, you totally see that he now has that taste.
It's like, maybe he's the one who, like, destroyed, like, kills Cable's family instead of the little like, kid. It's like, oh, no.
I was expecting, like, a post-credit scene of something like that. Like, yeah, I think that's one of the reasons why I didn't really dig the joke that much. Is like, it seemed like a lot of setup. And then there is a punchline at the end. And, you know, it's like, okay, that's a pretty good punchline. But I kept thinking, like, yeah, man, there's a post-credits scene of him being the one that destroys the future. That's a way better punchline, considering how much you set this up.
Yeah, and that's the third Deadpool movie. Just
yeah. I swear, if he is the villain of the next Deadpool film, I will take all of these criticisms back, because that was a hell of a setup for that name. Way to go. If there is a third Deadpool film, that's a weird thing. Who even knows?
Yeah.
Like, I actually expected him to die in this film, because I was like, yeah, man, again, you were making this at the time of the Fox-Disney deal. It would be a hell of a, like, turn and wink and nod at the audience to be like, yeah, we kind of have to kill me now because I ain't coming back under Disney unless I do. And then it's in a different universe, so hey, screw it.
I just realized, like, now that, like, he's been singing, like, Disney songs, too.
I thought that, too.
It's like, huh, what a coincidence.
Which,
like,
by the way, the Papa Can You Hear Me sounds exactly like, do you want to build a snowman? I'm like, fuck!
It's like, well, now, thank you for
now playing. I can't not hear that.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, although I will say, Do You Want Bill Snowman was probably my least favorite song from that entire movie. I know a lot of people love that song. I didn't really dig it all that much, so I kind of dig that the idea that, oh yeah, they just ripped up something off. But I kind of like Papa Can You Hear Me, so I don't know why.
You like the original.
It's like Barbra Streisand. That's another thing. Celine Dion does the intro song for this.
Yeah.
Good for her. Celine Dion is freaking great. I will not hide from that. Celine Dion is a very talented singer. And goddamn, that was a very talented song there at the beginning of this.
Speaking of the songs, there's like, there's some pretty interesting songs on this soundtrack.
This is, oh no, not the soundtrack. The score.
Score, yeah.
This, they announced this today. The score is the first score in cinema history to have the parental guidance on it. Not soundtrack, but score.
Oh,
and I was
yeah.
like, how on earth could I? And then it gets to the Juggernauts, yeah. like, apocalypse theme song.
Yeah.
Tomatoes! And, like, you know, the Omen music starts mm-hmm. playing with him, except that's motherfucker bullshit! And it's like,
holy shit!
That's
holy
it, yeah.
shit balls!
I was like, just the image of a room full of, like, professionally trained opera singers. And like a conductor there in the middle of them. And that's what they're saying. It's like, that's like the best gag in this entire film. And it's off screen. It's off screen during the production of this movie. But they put it in here so you would think of that joke. You would think of that image. This film really is fucking smart with a lot of these jokes. Don't get me wrong. I know I'm like complaining about like, okay, you know, maybe it wasn't as funny as the first one. And I didn't like that one running gag in there. Jokes are still really damn good in this.
Yeah.
And I gotta say, the best gag in this entire movie is the massive fuck you to the audience they give them with this. Cause they advertised the shit out of X-Force. They advertised X-Force like crazy in this thing. And X-Force pops up in here, and aside from Domino, is instantly killed off.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that was the last huge spoiler for this thing. But man, I remember Terry Crews comes down. And I want to know what a lot of X-Force fans think of this. Because they don't have, like, a lot of the main X-Force guys in there. Like, the main X-Force guys are Cable and Domino. Cable's not even a member of it in this movie. But Domino's the one who survives. A lot of the other ones they got here, like Shatterstar. I really like Shatterstar. But from the Peter David run on the book, like, way later down the line. No, that wasn't even X-Factor. That was X-Force. I'm sorry. That wasn't X-Force. That was X-Factor. Yes, Peach. I know I was wrong. But, yeah. Shatterstar on the old X-Force, he was always like a running gag because he was like the most Rob Liefeld looking character you've ever seen. And they give him the Rob Liefeld look with like the really baggy like genie pants and genie sleeves in here. And he's got like the really big headband on. Although I think, I heard someone online, I haven't looked this up and I'm sorry if I'm wrong. But I heard someone online say that the guy who got the role of Shatterstar in here is the guy who came in second for Iron Fist. And I'm like, if that's true, someone give this dude a franchise. Someone give him a character that'll stick around. Cause god damn, he deserves it. He's earned it, god damn it. But yeah, so Shatterstar, they've got Zeitgeist, which Zeitgeist wasn't even on like the main X-Force team. It was after they tried to reinvent X-Force, and he died the very first appearance he ever made. And then they had Bedlam in there, which I didn't actually know who Bedlam was. He was one of the members of X-Force I had never even heard of, I'll admit that. But a guy came into my comic book store, and he's a fan of the show. I don't know if he wants me saying his name or anything, but he came to the show, and he was really excited for this because he said he really liked Bedlam, and he was excited that Terry Crews was playing him. And I want to know what that guy thinks of all this. What do you think of what they did to this guy in here? Like, I really want to know, because that was immediately, as soon as Terry Crews goes out, at first I thought he'll be fine. He's Terry Crews. He's built like a tank. He'll be okay. But no, he ain't okay. He dies the way that he goes out. And I was just like, I wonder what that guy thought of this. Like, my mind immediately went to him. Vanisher dies in here, which again, Vanisher was very quickly a member of X-Force, not one like the main guys on there. But he dies, and he dies.
Poof, in a vanish. And
it's Brad Pitt.
Yes.
Goddamn, that was a good cameo in here.
And at least like for a split second too.
When he's being electrocuted, like you see like a flash of who it actually is because he's invisible. Mm-hmm. You see a flash of him, it's like, oh my gosh.
And the funny thing is like he doesn't even talk.
No, that would have cost extra.
But like that was like the gag, like that was the joke when they were like doing the interview. It was like, oh, because he vanished, like, or maybe he's late.
He's actually running late right now. So that's a good joke. And then there's just some random dude they introduce in here.
His name was like Pete, like
Pete. It was one of the monkeys. But yeah, I think it was Pete.
And he was just like a just regular a guy.
Just, and it was just like, yeah, I just saw the ad. I just thought it sounded fun. You're in. And I love that. That's like one of the few times that the cab driver wanting to be a train killer actually came back and really worked for me. Because he was in the room at the time and went, God damn it! I went, that, okay, alright. That's actually one of the few times I actually really like this joke. That joke actually really worked on this one. But yeah, they all just like instantly go out. And I have no idea how fans are going to react to that. Like, we're recording this on Friday. I'm just sitting here like, oh, fuck, like, Peach is upset about. Peach is a big X-Force fan. Peach wants to know why X-23 wasn't in this movie. Yeah, it's so weird just thinking about, I don't even know what to say about this. Because speaking of someone who doesn't really care, like, I've enjoyed X-Force in the comics, but again, it was like Wolverine and Psylocke and Archangel and Deadpool. It's like, yeah, that's my version of X-Force. The version that they just kill off in here is like, I didn't really care one way or another on this, guys.
Was that like the point? Like just taking like the most minor characters and just killing them off?
I think it was. Except that then I look at the fact that they got Terry Crews in here and I'm like, did you not know that Terry Crews was a big deal?
No, I think that's also part of the joke. Like they get like the big actors to like do these minor roles.
They get one of the most likable actors in the world to be a character in here just to instantly kill him off. They Expendables that guy. Except that in Expendables, Terry Crews wasn't a big name yet. Here, it's like, wow. It really does feel like they got Terry Crews in here just so that people would think, yeah, I can't wait to see Terry Crews in here. Oh, shit. Thank God Brooklyn Nine-Nine got renewed. Holy shit, yeah. I'm still like, I don't have words for it. I'm just kind of in shock that they pulled that off. That really is one of the best twists in any movie I have seen this year. That they just screwed the audience over that hard. And man, if I wasn't in shock, I would have stood up and looked around the audience just to see people's eyes. I really wish we had seen this at the UA Court Street.
Yeah.
Because that audience will talk back to the screen. I want to know what that audience would have said.
Yeah, but like the UA Court Street is like very unreliable. So.
It's true, yeah.
So like, I was like, when it comes to like Deadpool or like any other like big opening, like I'm better off, I feel like we're better off going to the
I do not want to see all the kids that were going to be running around in the Deadpool screen. You know there's like, you know there's at least 10 like 12-year-olds or younger at every single Deadpool screening happening at the UA Court Street right now.
Even though they specifically say, no, this is not a family film.
No, they say it is a family film.
But for the different reason.
For a different reason.
They say it's a family film as Deadpool shoots up everybody.
It's one of those weird things where it's like, I don't have kids and I don't want to come in here and judge because like, shit man, I might get wear down. I might get worn down. I'm a weak man. I might eventually get worn down by two, who knows. But yeah, anything else you want to say about this? Because I really did enjoy this film. Even if I think the first one was better.
Yeah, I agree with you, and that's really all I have to say about that.
Yes. But okay, last thing that we're going to talk about is the mid-credit scene.
Peach, come on, get up here.
Oh, you want attention, Peach. Yeah, there you go. Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's go ahead and talk about the mid-credit scene on this one. Because it's him taking Cable's time machine device and going back in time to save his girlfriend at the beginning of the film. And I was just like, is that canon? Because everything else he does in here, like after that, he goes back further and like he goes to Wolverine Origins and he kills his version of himself in that film. I was like, yay, that's fun. That's a fun joke that you put in there. He goes back and kills Ryan Reynolds as he's about to take on the Green Lantern script. I'm like, yay, that's a fun joke in there. All those are clearly jokes. This one feels, why would you put all those jokes in there with this one that's going to make us go, so is it, did he? Like, again, if there's a Deadpool 3, wow, you just chomped that finger. Nom, 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 nom. You were going ham on that hand. I'm not even gonna bother taking it away. There you go. Yeah, if there's a Deadpool 3, is she alive? What happened with all that?
I don't know.
Yeah, I'm very confused. Peach is confused too. She's trying to stare into my soul. I don't have anything else to say about that because I'm just confused.
Yeah.
And I know they'll probably answer it eventually, but again, it's one of those things where it's like, did you put this in here when the Fox Disney deal was going down? And you thought, yeah, fuck it, we're not gonna have to think about this. We're not making another one of these. Disney's gonna put a stop to it. I don't know.
We'll find out.
Yeah, we will. Because, I mean, yeah, of course there's gonna be a Deadpool 3 if they're allowed to make a Deadpool 3. But did they know they were gonna be allowed to make a Deadpool 3 when they went back there and put that in that post-credit scene? Because if not, it's a nice little post-credit scene of going, yay, she's still alive, they're still together, everything's happy, yay, Deadpool gets to ride off in the sunset. If not, it just raises questions now.
Mm-hmm.
Because again, yeah, the rest of that is all gags. Why would you have that be one of the gags though? It's so weird to me that they decided to go that route, but I mean, hey, it's Deadpool.
Mm-hmm.
That's the entire point of Deadpool.
That's basically sums up this whole P-Gore. It's like, it's Deadpool.
Da-da-da-da-da-da. What? There's a lot of little Easter eggs in here, too, that I noticed. What was one of them? When Domino is attacking the guy in the truck, Deadpool's saying, what kind of lame superpower is luck? What hack artist thought of that? Probably some guy who can't draw feet. And I'm like, that's a funny joke to throw at Rob Liefeld, especially since you like gave him like the cameo in the first film. But then I was thinking, like, I was looking for it in the credits. I want to know who was the truck driver she was fighting then, because he was like in full armor, like all you could see was his mouth. And I was like, if that's Rob Liefeld, she's beating up while he disses Rob Liefeld. That's an amazing cameo. But I don't know if it was. Again, that would be an amazing game. By the way, I want to go back and look at the credits on this thing, because there's jokes in the credits, because it said, voice of Juggernaut as himself. That's kind of a diss to John DiMaggio, though. Come on, man. Give John DiMaggio some credits. Literally, give him some credits. Because I'm assuming that's who it was. It sounded like John DiMaggio. It sounded like a combination between Bender and the guy from Gears of War. Let's see. What were some of the other ones? When Deadpool was a member of X-Force, his outfit wasn't black and red, it was black and gray.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end, when he gets blasted and his outfit turns gray, it's like, oh no, you got the outfit in there. Okay, that's where to go with that. That's kind of cool in there. I'm trying to think of any of the other Easter eggs. There's another one in here that I'm completely blanking on. I do want to know if they're going to sell that music box of Logan. Because they would make a mint off that. Man, there was another Easter egg in here that I am blanking on. I'm sure there's a lot of other ones in here that people are going to bring up. But yeah, those are some of the ones that I definitely noticed in here. God damn it, it's going to really bug me. I know there was another, like, big one in here. Oh, well, people will tell me what I got wrong. But yeah, thank you guys very much. Let us know what you thought about this film in the comments down below. You can always reach me on Twitter, Tumblr, Twitch, all those other places, at Professor Thorgy. And I will be back later this weekend to review something that isn't Deadpool, something probably very different. There's two movies coming out this weekend aside from Deadpool. One of them is Book Club, about a bunch of older ladies all coming together to discuss 50 Shades of Grey. And it's a story about finding yourself that late in life. And I was like, okay, I get why you would put that out, because that's definitely, what's it called? Anti-marketing. It's basically like, when you put something out that's supposed to be the exact opposite of the big release, so that all people who don't want to see that big release go and see it. I can't remember what that's called. But yeah, that's definitely what they're doing with that one. So it's like, okay, I get what you're doing. The other one is some movie called like Dog Show or something like that. And I have heard people talking about how awful it looks, and it's got terrible score on Rotten Tomatoes. But apparently it's also supposed to be a comedy. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, why the fuck would you put a comedy out in the same weekend as Deadpool unless you know it was shit and you wanted it to be buried? Like, you wanted to go, hey, it's not our fault. Like, no one went and saw it. We put it out the same time as Deadpool. Who could have known that was going to be big? It's like, everybody knew it was going to be big. So I don't know which of those I want to go and see. Because on the one hand, if that Dog Show film is as bad as everyone says, people love to see me talk about bad movies. But on the other hand, man, I kind of need something that isn't superheroes right now. Isn't superheroes, isn't comedy, isn't like any of this stuff. And I feel like Book Club is the most opposite of a summer blockbuster I can get right now. Although I will say, this movie came out at the perfect time. I remember that they kept like talking about how Deadpool got put so close to Avengers Infinity War because Fox was trying to screw over Disney and take some of their money away. Because they figured that Avengers Infinity War would keep going and going and going, except that Deadpool was going to take some of that money away. Man, I'm glad they put it so close to Avengers Infinity War. After Avengers Infinity War, we needed something like this to be like, oh good, I can laugh again. Especially after the movie I watched last weekend.
Yeah, everything is okay. She lives. Like, yeah. He lives. Everyone lives.
Wait, I don't feel so good. Wait, never mind. You went back in time. Wow. Both movies involve someone going back in time, except that in Avengers Infinity War is to destroy everyone, and this one's to save someone. Wow. There's comparisons. It's the same movie. Oh my god, both of them involve Josh Brolin going back in time. It's the same movie, really, honestly.
Yeah.
Alright, thanks for tuning in, everyone.
Bye.
Bye!